evening. I'm Nisa Sorolnik.
I'm Jay Kaplan.
I'm Steve Ferguson.
And I'm Scott Chapman.
And this is On the Sportslines for October 8th, 2009. October means baseball playoffs are underway. We'll take a look at each division series and then give you our World Series predictions. We've also got a preview of Week 5 for the Jets and Giants, plus a report from the Fantasy Genius. As always, we want to hear from you, so send your emails to fanspeak@onthesportslines.com. We just may read yours on the show. It took a dramatic 12-inning win over the Tigers in a one-game playoff, but the Twins are AL Central champs. They'll face the Yankees in the ALDS, while the Red Sox take on the Angels in the other ALDS. The NLDS will pit the Dodgers against the Cardinals, while the Phillies play the Rockies. Jay, let's start with the Yankees-Twins series. What are you going to be focusing on in that one?
Well, for the Yankees, I'm going to be focusing on pitching, shall I go on. Since being up 3-0 against the Red Sox in the 2004 ALCS, the Yankees are 4-13 in the postseason. Their starters are 2-9 with a 6.30 ERA. Doesn't bode well, right? CC Sabathia in his last two postseasons is 1-3 with a 9.47 ERA. Again, does not bode well.
However, he did pretty good last night.
He was the Sabathia they were hoping they would get, the guy who's been dominant all year, 6 2/3, only allowed 2 runs, struck out 8. The Yankees, a very important stat here, the Yankees led the American League in strikeouts this year. Mm. And as we all know, in the postseason, it's important to be able to get that key strikeout in a key situation. The other thing I'm going to focus on in terms of the pitching is A.J. Burnett going Friday night. Now, there's a little bit of controversy if you've been paying attention, because Joe Girardi, and I think this is the right move, this is the playoffs, egos have to go out the window, Molina will catch Burnett as opposed to Posada. Georgie, I know you're not happy about it, dude, but the numbers don't lie, okay? With Molina, Burnett has a 3.28 ERA, opponents are hitting 2.21. With Posada behind the plate, he has a 4.42 ERA, opponents are hitting 2.70. In Burnett's last 6 starts, all with Molina behind the plate, 3-1, a 2.92 ERA. The Yankees can get that kind of production out of Burnett, all-reliable Andy Pettit going in Game 3, they look good.
Yep, they will. And here's what I'm looking at. I'm looking at the Twins. They have to hit. And for a couple of reasons. They're missing Justin Morneau. And what they did to get to this point is phenomenal. The guys have stepped up. Maurer, Kadire, Kubel, Delman Young. They got to use their speed. They have to play smart. But those four guys have to hit for power. If they do, the Yankee lineup, which is an incredibly powerful lineup, and they have great pitching, if these guys can at least hit well enough, they'll stay in the game with the Yankees.
You know, you talk about what they did without Morneau. That 17-4 run to close the season, to even get them into the playoffs, was done all without Justin Morneau.
And it tells you what kind of gritty, competitive team this really is.
Yep.
They're a gritty, competitive team. I'll give you guys all that, but let's be serious. They don't have a chance against them. They don't have a chance. If they get a game, it'll be a miracle. Because what has really happened to them, and my view on this whole series is, I think they're at a huge disadvantage having to play that one game series on Tuesday and then go right into fly to New York to play this first game of the playoffs. Now, I know, you know, I get the scheduling. I get that the Homer Dome wasn't open on Monday. I get, you know, clinch your spot early. You don't have to worry about that, blah, blah, blah. But the reality is Major League Baseball made them play that game at 8 p.m. They should have had them play it at 1 p.m. Now you got to play that game late just for some ratings.
Yeah.
The game went into extra innings. They
didn't
get out.
Actually, they started at 5.
Yeah, they started at 5.
Did they start
at 5?
It just went really late.
Is that what the problem was?
Long time. Yeah, 5 o'clock.
Well, thank you for correcting me. But
they still could have started it at 1,
they could have started at 1. They could have started at 2. They're burying this Cardinal-Philly series at 2 o'clock starts.
Yeah.
And this is the extra game that was on the schedule anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, you know, now, so their rotation now was all messed up. Their number 5 closer started the first game. I don't think they have a chance. I think they're going
to use practically all their players in that 12-inning game. So, you know. Nobody's in the right frame. Nobody's in the right, you know, sense of order.
Especially in game one. I think that was a given pretty much that they were going to get that
one. I give
them
a lot of credit for getting there, but their run is pretty much done.
You won't hear me arguing, Scott.
I hope you're right. Well, guys, let's also take a look at the Red Sox and Angels series. Scott, what are you going to watch for in this one?
Oh, well, you know, this is going to be an interesting matchup. I think this is very, very evenly matched team, although I do think the Angels are the better team this year. What's interesting to me is that this is the third year in a row that these guys have met in the first round of the playoffs. And as we know, it's also the fourth time since 2004. The Red Sox have won the last 3. They've won them 9-1. It really hasn't been competitive. And so some of these Angels are itching at a chance to get back at the Red Sox. And some of the Red Sox are saying, well, you know, we've been there, we've done that, we can take these guys out. I think their key the Angels, from their perspective, is Brian Fuentes. This guy has blown seven saves this year. He has 41 saves on the year, but he's blown seven. He's got an ERA over four. I think it's 4.4, I believe it is. Now, what can happen? He blows one of these first two games to the Red Sox. Let's say Big Poppy takes him deep in the top of the ninth.
Yep.
This could be a carryover effect. Now they got to go to Fenway to play two games. They could be gone.
This is true. And you know, I kind of lean a little bit towards the Angels. I know Fuentes is a possible, maybe.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Their starting pitching is solid. They can hit with the Red Sox. And here's the thing that gives them the edge. The Angels can run. And the Red Sox have shown no ability to shut down the running game. In the regular season, Angels were 15 of 17 stolen bases against the Red Sox. And you know they were paying attention to that last Yankee-Red Sox series in the Bronx, where the Yankees ran completely roughshod over the Red Sox, including seven stolen bases in one game.
Yeah, Veritek stolen like Mike Piazza these days.
Worse.
Yeah, probably worse. And I'll tell you, the other thing you need to look at is the pitching. Both of these teams have really good pitching. The Red Sox, if Beckett and Lester are on, could be a really, really good series. Those two can dominate. But the Angels have such wealth of pitching. I mean, if you look at Lackey, Jared Weaver, Saunders, Palmer, Matt Palmer, rookie, 10-2 out of the who's in the bullpen, Irvin Santana. Mm-hmm. I mean, they have pitching, so it can be a great series.
You know, and the thing that concerns me, Steve, you talk about the Red Sox pitching. Beckett has been on and off a little bit
with some back trouble.
And right now they still haven't figured out who's pitching game three yet. That makes you wonder if there's something wrong with Buchholz.
Right. Yeah,
that's
so
true.
We'll see.
That's true. Well, guys, let's move over to the NL now. In the Cardinals-Dodgers series, Steve, what are you going to be watching for in this
one? I'm going to be watching to see if this Cardinal bullpen can protect leads. They have a whole group of no names. Nobody really knows who these guys are. Mott, Hawksworth, Trevor Miller. The only one you might know is Ryan Franklin. That's because he's been around in the days when he was a starter in Seattle.
Yep.
He's been a little shaky as the closer. So this is a team that's going to rely on their starting pitching, particularly Carpenter, Wainwright, and Pinheiro, who really has to step up as the number three guy.
Yeah, you know, Carpenter and Wainwright, best 1-2 punch in the game. Yeah. I don't think those two guys have lost back-to-back starts at any point during the year, so that bodes well for La Russa.
It does.
Yeah, the Cardinals definitely have the advantage in the starting pitching. The Dodgers' starting pitching in the second half has really struggled, and it's part of the reason with that rocky run why they almost blew this whole division.
Yep.
Yeah, that's very true.
Now, you Yankee fans know that Joe Torre plays the postseason by shortening that game, cutting it to six innings. And this is what the Dodgers have to do. They have to survive their starting pitching and get to that bullpen.
Yep.
They have a strong bullpen, in my opinion.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
They got George Sherrill that they got in that midseason deal with Baltimore.
Yep,
he's thrown to a 1.7 ERA. They got Jonathan Brockton. His ERA is 2.62. And they got
Kuo,
the Asian gentleman, who's pitching to a 3.0 ERA. But what's interesting about these guys is, Jay, you talk about not pitching to contact.
Mm-hmm.
These three guys have 207 strikeouts in 175 innings.
Yep.
And that's what you need coming out that bullpen in the postseason. So I think if the Dodgers can get to that point and still be in the game, I think they have the advantage that way. It's just from the starting pitching, and they have a good chance to win the series.
Mm-hmm. I hear you guys, and you know what? It does focus on pitching. However, to me, I'm keeping an eye on Pujols and Ramirez. Which one of these guys is going to have the big series? And you say, Jay, these guys are two of the best hitters in the game. What's the deal? Well, neither one of them hit particularly well against the opposition in this series. Pujols against the Dodgers this year, 222, one homer, two RBI. In game one, he walked twice, did not hit a ball out of the infield. Ramirez, 143, no homers, one RBI in the regular season against St. Louis. He is the number one guy all time in home runs, so he may step up. Mm. The thing is that I think the Dodgers are more capable of surviving a Manny down series with Ethier, Kemp, and Loney than the Cardinals are if Pujols doesn't, you know, bring his A game. Yeah, you got Matt Holliday, but before his second inning, you know, his game two home run tonight, he had only hit one in his last 79 at-bats. And after him, who do they got? Ludwig, DeRosa? I think it's going to come down to which star actually has the best series.
Interesting.
That's true. Well, guys, finally, Phillies-Rockies. Scott, what is the key thing to watch for this one?
Well, I'm going to play Captain Obvious right now. The Rockies, as we know, they won this afternoon. The Rockies had to get out of Philadelphia with a split. They got out of the split, but the reason why I say that is because they are at a great disadvantage because their hottest pitcher, Jorge De La Rosa, who went 16-3 after June 1st of this year, he's out this series with a groin injury, so he's not going to be there.
Ouch.
That puts them at a huge disadvantage. And when you have Cliff Lee pitching like he did in game one, he has another start in him. They have to do everything they can to win the games that Lee is not pitching. So now they get to go back to Colorado. They can regroup. We know from 2007 that stadium gets crazy during the postseason.
Oh, absolutely. Yes, it does.
And they have a big opportunity to win some games and try to steal the series.
Mm-hmm. Well, for me, it's basically looking at the Phillies and saying, the starting pitching, if they burn these guys out, and I'm talking about Lee and Hamels in particular, those two guys, if they're burned out, that bullpen is a walking disaster. I mean, everybody in that bullpen, you look at Lidge, who's been horrible, Madsen, all these guys, you don't know what to expect in that bullpen. So the question is, can the starters hold up? Can Blanton, who's also not an innings eater since he's been in the National League, can he pitch 8 innings if necessary?
You know, Steve, you played directly into my point. Brad Lidge, who, as we all know, was perfect last year, was anything but this year. 0-8, 7.21 ERA, blew 11 saves. The guy was as hittable this year as he was unhittable last year. If he cannot do the job and Madsen is forced to close, with Romero being hurt, that bullpen has completely lost its depth, and that was what powered them last year along with that offense to the championship.
Definitely.
If you look at the Rockies, on the other hand, Houston Street, nobody's really talking about this guy, but he only blew 2 saves this year, and he was very solid for the Rockies. Yeah. It's the bridge to him that is a little suspect. I mean, Contreras got his butt whipped in game 2 today. So it's a question of, can Lidge be the man again? And can the bridge to Street be as effective as they need him to be? Whichever one of those factors comes into play in the positive side, to me, will determine who wins this series.
Good point. That's a good point.
That's a really good point. Well, okay, guys, so now it's time for our predictions. Tell me who is going to be in the World Series. Jay, tell me first.
Well, I'm going to go traditional. Yankees, Dodgers.
Wow. Well, I'm going to go with Dodgers-Angels. I think it's going to be a California
series.
Yes.
I'm going to stick with my preseason prediction. I'm going to agree with Jay. I'm going to go Yankees-Dodgers.
All right.
Well, I also, about a month ago, I
did.
Predicted on this very show, I did say Yankees and Dodgers, so I'm going to stick to my guns and say that, even though I didn't realize everyone else would be saying that, too.
Great minds think alike. That's all that means.
Yep.
So, you know,
I don't know what Steve's doing
stuff every now and then.
And I think the Yankees will take it.
All right. Wow, there you go. She's getting very confident.
Well, baseball's postseason may have center stage, but fantasy football season is already in high gear. And the Genius has some trade ideas to help you fantasy GMs improve your team. James?
Summer's over and things are cooling down, but every Sunday, football is heating up. Hopefully, your players are reaching for 6. But if they don't make it, we'll just kick for 3. Hi, this is James Ferguson, the Fantasy Genius, here with your review. You're 4 weeks deep into your fantasy football season, and by now should have a pretty good idea as to your team's potential. If things haven't gone your way early on, maybe it's time you make a trade. Here are some tips from the Fantasy Genius. Tip 1. Don't panic. Don't trade your top draft picks for a player playing above their expectations. Numbers don't lie, and there's a reason why those players were drafted where they were. Tip 2. Sell high and buy cheap. Let me give you an example. Tony Romo lit up the fantasy scoreboards with 3 scores in week 1, and since then has thrown more interceptions than touchdowns. If you had sold him after the first week, you could have gotten a pretty penny. Now he's considered a risky start at best. Hey, Tony, wrong uniform.
Tip 3.
Scheduling. An experienced fantasy player is constantly aware of his players' bye weeks and matchups. When negotiating a trade, look for players who have favorable matchups, such as the Lions' run defense or the Titans' secondary, who's allowed over 1,100 yards in the first 4 weeks. No Haynesworth, no pass rush. With that being said, let's take a look at Fergie's Fantasy Top 5 Bargain Buys.
Number 5.
Donovan McNabb. After making the Eagles look invincible in week 1, Donovan injured his ribs trying to score. All sources are saying he should be back in week 5, so this is a great time to buy.
Number 4.
Steve Slayton. Slayton had a miserable first 3 weeks, rushing on average for 42 yards with no touchdowns. Look for him to bounce back with a comfortable midseason schedule. And he did have a great week 4.
Number 3.
Brandon Jacobs. Brandon is also off to a slow start, failing to surpass 100 yards in a game in the first 4 weeks, and only scoring 1 rushing touchdown.
Number 2.
Steve Smith. A perennial fantasy monster has yet to reach the end zone and has only broken 100 yards once this season. Players of his magnitude are always worth the risk.
Number 1.
Terrell Owens. T.O. has been a no-show in Buffalo, only scoring 1 touchdown and posting a goose egg in week 3. Expect Terrell to find the end zone and bounce back with quality fantasy numbers.
That's it for this week, folks. And until next time, I'm James Ferguson.
Thanks, James. And remember, you can email your fantasy questions to the genius at fantasyminute@onthesportslines.com. The Jets were handed their first loss of the season last week, while the Giants remain undefeated. The Jets are in Miami to face the Dolphins on Monday night, while the Giants play host to the Oakland Raiders on Sunday. Scott, the Jets' defense did its job against the Saints' prolific passing attack, but the offense had some problems. What needs to be done for the Jets to get a win in Miami?
Well, I mean, this game, although the Saint game got all the hype, this game is much more important because it's a divisional game. The Jets need to establish the run. Miami, you know, they had a big win over Buffalo last week.
They're pumped up.
Right, and if anybody saw that game against Indianapolis, which they lost, they controlled the ball for 45 minutes of that game. One time of possession, 45-15. That's what they want to do with this Wildcat and with their backup quarterback in essence, Chad Pennington, is done for the season. So the Jets need to establish the run, which they have not been doing. Thomas Jones led the AFC last year with 1,300 yards. He averaged 4.5 yards a carry. This year, he's averaging 57 yards a game, 3.8 yards a carry. Their best rusher was actually Sean Green against the Saints the other
day. That's right. That's true.
So they've got to come back and find a way to get this running game going. You know, I mean, it's going to, everything's hand goes hand in hand. It'll relieve pressure off Sanchez and the rest of this team. And they want to control that time possession because that's what Miami wants to do.
Mm-hmm. You know, Scotty, I'll be interested to see how Sanchez bounces back from his first bad game of the season. 14 of 27 for 138, three interceptions, one lost fumble, a 27 passer rating, the fumble and one interception directly resulting in two New Orleans Saints touchdowns. Yeah. Darren Sharper getting a pick six, and you know the fumble recovery in the end zone. Now, there would appear, at least on paper, to be some help on the horizon, as Braylon Edwards is now officially a Jet.
Woo-hoo.
Now, the question is which Braylon Edwards are the Jets getting? The diva who can't seem to stay out of trouble off the field and can't seem to hang on to footballs on it, or the guy who in 2007 caught 80 balls for almost 1,300 yards and 16 touchdowns? If they get that guy, Sanchez is going to jump up and down because he's got early Christmas. If they get the other guy, he's going to be going, oh, no.
And speaking of, oh, no, that offensive line, oh, no, how horrible were they last week? You know what? He's a rookie quarterback, and you know what? He moved in the pocket. He did everything he could do. He got out of there. He ran. He wasn't a sitting target. But the line was horrible.
Absolutely.
I mean, these guys were in New Orleans. They were flying around. I remember this guy Grant coming right from the backside, beating all the offensive linemen. Guys, you've got to protect him. Yeah, he can move well now, but if you keep this up, it'd be like Joe Namath in a few years. He'll have horrible knees, and he won't be able to move at all. Come
on. He keeps getting sacked four times every game. He's not going to last the full season.
Exactly.
And guys, don't forget that Jets defense has got to stop that two-headed rushing attack of the Dolphins with Ronnie Brown and Ricky Williams. They've just been amazing. The Dolphins are actually the number two ranked rushing offense in the NFL right now.
Wow.
So, I mean, the Jets defense really has their hands full. But on the bright side for the Jets, the Dolphins don't have much of a passing game. So that shouldn't be too hard to control.
You hope.
And Ted Ginn is just like Braylon Edwards. He drops everything he's thrown to.
Wow.
Well, Jay, the Giants are 4-0 for the second straight year, but is Eli's injury cause for concern against the Raiders?
You know, it's ironic that Eli's first big injury is an injury most associated with the NBA, plantar fasciitis. He's going to be in pain, but it is manageable. He's just going to cowboy up and soldier on. You know what? This is the Oakland Raiders. I don't think you can expect a 20 for 34, 292, three touchdown game like he had last week against Kansas City. But I don't think they'll need it against the Raiders. I think you will see a lot more of Bradshaw and Jacobs, and they are both going to have to bring it. 156 yards combined on a 4.7 average. That's not bad. That'll do it. But they're going to have to do better. I think earlier in the year, you saw Eli basically carrying the running game and the defense to some extent. Now the running game and the defense are going to have to return the favor. But I don't think they'll take much. After all, guys, this is the Raiders.
The Raiders, yeah.
Yeah, I don't think the Giants are going to have a problem this week. One thing that really has impressed me with these Giants so far is the emergence of Steve Smith as a big-time
pass
receiver.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Now, I'm racking my brains. I don't remember whether the fantasy genius told me to draft this guy. So I got to talk to Fergie about that.
And he's gone from the other Steve Smith to
these
Steve Smith. Yeah, he really has.
And interestingly enough, I have that other Steve Smith.
I saw
the Giants Steve Smith stats on Sunday. He was 11 catches, 134 and 2 touchdowns. I got excited until I realized, oh, this is not the one I got. But anyway, on the season, he's the leading receiver in the league. He's got 34 catches for 411 yards. He's got 4 TDs. And to be honest, I mean, you know, he could be headed to the Pro Bowl.
Who would have thought that?
I mean, yep. That was the big question for the Giants coming to the season. Who would step up and replace Plexico Burress as that number one option for Eli? Because a lot of experts believe that that whole Plexico situation and the downfall of his career cost the Giants a shot at the Super Bowl last year. Mm-hmm. Steve Smith is fitting right in.
No, I mean, we talked about it on the preseason show. How are the Giants going to handle the loss of Burress and the loss of Amani Toomer? They seem to have done quite well, Steve.
Well, he's so reliable catching the ball, but now he's proven to people he's not just a possession receiver.
Yep, right.
And speaking of those who are assisting him, how about Mario Manning?
Yeah.
I'm going to call him Super Mario if he continues playing like this. He's been awesome. And, you know, this is a guy who had some problems with maturity. He had some problems off the field with drugs. People weren't sure about his ability to play at this level, and he's worked his butt off. He went from being pretty much a bench player to being a guy that you can trust. And you got to give him a lot of credit. Eli trusts his receivers, which is, I think, the key. He really does, and these guys have confidence now.
Yeah, and, you know, I mean, after all, guys, I mean, like I said, we're talking about the Raiders, and is it me or is Jamarcus Russell become this generation's Ryan Leaf?
Oh,
it appears
God.
That way so
yes,
far.
It's, he's you know, getting there. He's getting there.
It is sad to see what the Raiders have actually devolved into.
Devolved, that's very
and
good.
And they have to fly across the country to play this game. No. This doesn't look good for them. But I mean, no. Do you guys think Eli should even play?
You know what? I think he should if he feels he can go. There's really nothing you can do with plantar fasciitis except basically sit on your couch and put your foot up for an entire year. Eli's not going to do that. No. Okay? He's going to play. The Giants will do their best to protect him. And if they're lucky, they'll be up 35-0 at halftime. Yeah. And then David Carr can play the second
exactly.
half.
Exactly what I'm thinking.
The reality is he should play against this team because he can get used to playing with the pain because he's going to be in pain for the rest of the season.
Yeah.
And you might as well get used to playing with the pain against the Raiders because the Raiders are probably not going to compete very well anyway.
Though I'll tell you, it wouldn't surprise me if the Giants start working in a little more max protect on Eli because you know they got to start preparing for the blitzes that are going to come, especially from Dallas.
That's true.
That's
that music means it's time for the 3-minute warning. Jay, lead off.
Thanks. George Steinbrenner has been a lot of things in his time as the owner of the Yankees. Not all of them have been good. In the 70s, he was King George, autocratic tyrant who ran roughshod over players, managers, fans, and this city. The team won 2 titles, but practically everyone, including me, hated him. In the 80s, he was the boss, wheeling and dealing, ignoring his GMs, and throwing money everywhere when there was a free agent he just had to have in pinstripes. The team didn't win any titles, and most of us, including me, still didn't like him. In the 90s, he was Mr. Steinbrenner. He made the occasional outburst when he felt the player, Joe Torre, Brian Cashman, or the team in general weren't living up to his standards, but winning 4 World Series titles between 1996 and 2000 softened him enough that our tolerance of him, including mine, grew. Now he's simply George. For most of this decade, his presence at the stadium, like his health, has declined. He stepped back and let his sons and Cashman run the team. And thus George Steinbrenner, at age 79, has become a revered grandfather loved by almost all. As the postseason began, Derek Jeter shouted a rallying cry of win one for George. My 10-year-old self would be amazed that I'm saying this, but it would be a beautiful thing if they could win one more for the old man.
Jorge Posada. Usually I don't talk about that New York baseball team on the dark side of town, but I have to when the yammering is going down. In the Yankees universe, everything seemed to be going fine. That is until Georgie Boy started to moan and whine. This proud Yankee is seething and highly upset. Why? Because Jose Molina will be catching A.J. Burnett. Could it be that your barking, ego, and arrogance gets on some pitcher's nerves on any given day? Try asking El Duque or David Wells in their prime. See what they'd say. Berating them while you fire the ball hard to their collective glove? I've seen your ire firsthand. You'd probably call it tough love. These guys have a hard enough job pitching to tough hitter after tough hitter. They need guidance and calm leadership, not some angry, immature babysitter. Bob Gibson once told former catcher Tim McCarver, all you know is that a baseball is hard to hit. That's why Molina gets the Game 2 playoff assignment. And this time, you will have to sit.
Yesterday, it was announced that the Jets traded for Braylon Edwards, ending their search for a stud wideout to complete their offense. During the preseason, they made inquiries to Denver about Brandon Marshall, and later, allegedly tampered with newly signed 49er Michael Crabtree. Obviously, all they needed to do was call their old friend, Eric Mangini. When we first met Mangenius, he was a little-known 20-year-old assistant under then-Jet defensive coordinator, Bill Belichick. From there, we all know the story. He followed Bill to New England, left Bill for the Jets. Bill got mad and awkward post-game handshakes were exchanged. His Jet run turned for the worse, and he was fired after that last season's collapse. To everyone's surprise, he was immediately hired by the Cleveland Browns and has seemingly done everything possible to be despised by every person in Cleveland. But in New York, they are loving him again. His draft day deal allowed the Jets to get Mark Sanchez. Now he gift wraps a former All-Pro receiver for them. Why? Is he trying to screw Belichick? Is he being extorted by the Jets? Did Edwards' weekend fight seal his fate in Cleveland? When dealing with Mangenius, you may never know, but right now, Jet fans don't care.
Well, 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 Michael Crabtree finally sucked it up and signed a 6-year contract with the 49ers after several months of holding out. Crabtree was acting like a diva before he even played one down in the NFL. He had a great college career, sure, but so what? This is the NFL. Who's to say it'll translate? He thought he deserved to be paid the same or more than Oakland's Darius Hayward Bay and Jacksonville's Eugene Monroe, who were drafted ahead of him at number 7 and 8. That's not how it works, Michael. You were drafted number 10, and even if that was a surprise to most people, that's still the way it went down. It's not the 49ers' fault that other teams passed on you. Their original offer was more than reasonable and pretty standard for the 10th pick in the draft. I wonder if this sudden change of heart had anything to do with the fact that the 49ers are 3-1 and appear to be doing fine without him. I think he realized if he held out any longer and the team continued to do well, they might even offer him less money. Michael, now it's time to prove you're worth the trouble and that you can be a big-time NFL playmaker. So come to work, get over your bitterness, stop acting like a baby, be a good teammate, and play some football. For Jay Kaplan, Steve Ferguson, and Scott Chapman, I'm Nisa Cerulnik. Thanks for spending part of your evening with us. We'll see you on October 22nd for another edition of On the Sportslines. And remember, if you want to see this show again or catch up on any of the ones you might have missed, check us out at youtube.com/onthesportslines. And if you want to see what we're talking about when we're not on the air, check out onthesportslines.blogspot.com. Good night, everyone.
Night, everybody.
Good night, everyone. Good night.